I call upon the first one, Dr. Hema VK. Is she here? Okay, you are here. So she would be presenting COVID-19 related cranial neuropathies, a case series during the second wave. I think you can start.
On 11th March 2020, the World Health Organization declared the novel coronavirus disease caused by SARS-CoV-2 as a pandemic. It produces symptoms ranging from asymptomatic disease to fatal acute respiratory distress syndrome or death, depending upon the comorbidities and state of the immune system. Aim of this case series is to document cranial nerve neuropathy in COVID patients and to analyze the possible pathogenesis and prognosis in these patients. This is a retrospective study of a case series of 10 patients who presented to a neuro-ophthalmology department at a tertiary eye care hospital from May 2021 to July 2021, that is during the second wave, and they were followed up for a period of 3 months. Inclusion criteria included patients with cranial nerve palsy who were recently diagnosed positive for COVID-19, and exclusion criteria was patients with cranial nerve palsy who were COVID negative. Demographic data showed most of the patients were between the age group of 30 to 60. Very few were below 30, that is two patients, and two patients were above 60 years. And most of the patients were males. Presenting complaints were mainly double vision, drooping of upper eyelid, or referred from other specialties. Cranial nerves involved can be categorized into two groups: isolated neuropathy, which included sixth nerve and third nerve, and multiple cranial nerve neuropathies, which included 2, 3, 4, 5, and sixth nerve. 3 out of our 10 patients had isolated cranial nerve palsies, 2 had sixth nerve and 1 had third nerve. 7 out of our 10 patients had multiple cranial nerve palsies. 1 out of the 3 isolated cranial nerve palsies had systemic illness uncontrolled, that is diabetes, but had good vision on presentation. Multiple cranial nerve palsies all had uncontrolled diabetes or hypertension or heart disease and had vision less than or equal to hand movements on presentation. Only one patient was treated as OPD basis. Rest of the 9 patients were admitted in hospital, and 2 out of the 6 patients were on intensive care unit. The MRI showed either sinus involvement in the form of invasive pan-sinusitis or maxillary sinusitis, orbital involvement showing orbital apex soft tissue thickening, or intracranial involvement showing cerebritis or cavernous sinus extension. Severity of the sinusitis in this patient ranged from mild to invasive fungal sinusitis. 5 were diagnosed fungal etiology and on MRI, and only one patient was biopsy-proved mucormycosis. Other relevant findings included fundus of the 2 patients had central artery occlusion, and 2 had optic atrophy, and 1 had disc edema. We could only find the chest imaging of 2 patients, which was normal. The patient with cranial nerve palsies who had negative neuroimaging were either treated, were treated with conservatively, and patients who had invasive fungal sinusitis was referred to ENT specialist and undergone debridement. 3 patients with mononeuropathy had good prognosis with complete recovery. Out of the 7 multiple cranial nerve palsy patients, 2 had intracranial involvement and they succumbed to death. Rest 4 had good prognosis, and the other 4 had either visual or movement deficits. This is the overall summary of the presentations. So we did a publication research, and we found that there was a case series of 6 patients with isolated cranial nerve palsies in COVID-19 patient. They postulated that the cause of the cranial nerve palsies in COVID-19 may be due to direct invasion of the endothelial cells by virus, or secondary infected leukocytes causing pro-inflammatory mediators, or either the acute virus illness causing hypertensive episodes or uncontrolled diabetes. MRI of these patients and orbit should be done, and they highlighted this, but they told that no neurological, no sixth nerve radiological findings were seen in the sixth nerve palsy patient. Presenting complaints were ophthalmoplegia or visual loss. Associated comorbidities in this group was diabetes mellitus, similar to our study. Mycological analysis revealed infection with mucor or aspergillus, similar to our studies. And the MRI showed either sinonasal, orbital, or cerebral palate involvement. The overall survival rate in that study was 63.89. In our study was 80%. So the pathogenesis may be uncontrolled systemic illness, secondary infections, or COVID virus. So we conclude that post-COVID patients can have either isolated or multiple cranial palsies. External ophthalmoplegia can be the presenting complaint in invasive sinusitis. Multiple canine palsies have poor prognosis, and multiple canine palsies patients are usually seen patients with comorbidities. Neuroimaging showing invasive sinusitis is in most patients with multiple canine palsies. So the take-home message is, we highlight that ophthalmologists should be also included in the cases of multiple canine palsies, especially in COVID-19 patients, because that can highlight how we can predict the prognosis of these patients. Thank you.
No, sir.
No. So even if the patient would have not infected with COVID,
yes, sir,
you would have got the palsies.
Yes, sir.
So it is not at all related to COVID.
Sir, but
actually, it accidentally happened in post-COVID zone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So it is not at all related, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, that's why I want to know. Thank you.
In those cases, how many were COVID antibody positive in the series?
Sir, all were COVID antibody positive.
Okay.
Have you tested the COVID antibodies?
Yes, sir.
You tested?
Yes,
and
sir.
What is, you, have you noted the duration between the canine lobe palsy and the occurrence of the COVID?
Sir, the patients who had...
Is there any relation between...
Patients who were COVID positive within 1 month of the presentations, we had included only that patients.
Okay, they were coming to you within 1 month of having the COVID?
Yes, sir.
Okay.